Greetings, Earthlings, 'tis I, Outfoxed, and I am the worst video gamer in the world. And you're watching Bethany, Orphan of the Wastelands. This is episode 30, Take It Back, the final quest of Vanilla Fallout 3. I say vanilla because the first DLC, Broken Steel, chronologically actually occurs after the events of Fallout 3. So this is the final quest of the base game. Alright, after knocking a big hole through the effective presence of the Enclave, we are now on our way to speak with Elder Lyons.
The more time they have to shore up their defenses, we should hit them sooner rather than later.
We barely have the manpower to keep the Citadel fortified. We've been over this before, Sarah.
So we just wait until they decide we're next on the list? If the Pride goes in now, we might have a chance.
And if you fail, then what? The risk is not worth the reward.
I agree. Without the Geck, the Purifier is useless to the Enclave anyway. They may give up before long.
I don't like it.
You don't have to like it, Sarah. You just have to follow orders.
Yes, Father.
So, you're back. We had feared both you and the Geck were lost. Were you successful?
Well, sort of. I found the Geck.
Excellent. With that, we hold the key to keeping the Enclave from controlling the Purifier.
The Enclave took the Geck. They're installing it now.
Then we must go at once. If you have any other information, tell me now before we mobilize. Any help you can give might save lives.
Interesting to note, Eden wanted me to sabotage the project with some kind of virus, with the FEV virus. The Enclave is fractured. The Enclave doesn't have the activation code. Raven Rock is destroyed. Every one of these is pertinent to the given situation, but you're only allowed to answer with one. And as far as I can tell, it's just flavor text anyway. It makes no difference to the upcoming chapter. The Enclave is fractured. They're not as unified as they'd like us to believe.
That's good news. Perhaps we can use it to our advantage. Still, we cannot afford to wait and see what happens. It seems we must act now.
If the Enclave has the Geck, there's nothing stopping them from starting the Purifier. They'll figure out the code eventually.
I'm afraid you're right. We need to act now while we can.
Send the Pride in. We can do it. We can win this.
All right, Sarah. The Pride goes in. But I want them to have some extra firepower. Rothschild, is it ready?
What? No, I mean, Lee and I have solved the power problems, but we've only barely finished diagnostic tests.
So?
It's not ready for field tests, let alone live fire situations. The weapons haven't been calibrated, the navigation detection system is offline.
Rothschild, enough. Can you make it work?
Honestly, I don't know. I think we can scrape by, and I suppose if we can't, it won't matter in the long run anyway.
Then it's decided. Sarah, you take the Pride and use the robot as support. Take our friend here and secure that purifier.
Yes, sir. Before we get started, I wanted to let you know that my father and I have been talking. The Pride and I have decided that after all you've survived, you've done enough to be an honorary member of Lion's Pride. Okay. So do you think you can hold it together for this?
Of course I can.
Now that's what I like to hear, soldier. You all packed? We're not coming back here anytime soon.
I'm all ready.
Okay, don't be nervous. You'll have the whole Pride backing you up, not to mention this giant tin can. Just stay safe until we reach the Purifier. You're no good to us if you're dead. And don't let that thing step on you. Okay, we're going to go over it one more time. The Pride is on me. The goal is Project Purity, but we can't get into the facility with those energy fields up. Rothschild and Lee say this robot should be able to take down the energy fields. So we're on fire support. We stay close to the thing, keep it clear, and get it to where it needs to go. Once the fields are down, we head straight for the facility. We'll use the robot to keep them occupied while we get inside and secure the control room. We need to move quickly before we lose the chance to surprise them. Get whatever supplies you don't already have, and we'll meet in the Bailey. When we're done with this, everyone can have a nice cold glass of water on me. Let's move. All right, Rothschild, fire it up. Pry, move out!
Okay, I noticed last time, or last episode, that unarmed is only 96. I was expecting to pick up the unarmed bobblehead a lot sooner in the storyline, and just, it never happened. We're going to go ahead and max our unarmed out. Now, 100, there's no point in going higher than 100. So, and yeah, we just dump the rest in energy weapons. Now, sadly, Quantum Chemist is not available, even though I meet the requirements, which is simply level 22. I'm guessing it's been disabled by Fallout Wanderer's Edition. And I guess I'll just do intense training and add one to strength. Thing brings our strength to 5. If you missed that part of the storyline, Liberty Prime was actually developed by the American military to fight the Chinese army in Anchorage, Alaska. So I mean, he actually thinks that he's fighting communists in China. So some of his commentary is just markedly out of play. It's kind of humorous. Okay, a little bit of battle readiness. I've nipped back to the trailer, got a full night's sleep, so we're well rested. I swapped out the alien blaster for the alien disintegrator. There's not going to be any close range shooting. Due to the mechanics of the battle, standing back is a real good idea. And because of her past, she has freed the slaves in The Pit, the Temple of the Union, Paradise Falls, and Evergreen Mills. We're going to go ahead and put her in the slave outfit. Stat-wise, it's the most battle-worthy item we have, and it really fits the character. And there goes Liberty Prime. I wasn't standing back far enough. If you watch, he just clips the building here. Alright, and the offensive is already in effect as we go. Liberty Prime has two attacks. He's got the eye laser thing, which is kind of a cone attack in front of him. And then he, on his backpack here, he carries nukes, which are kind of a targeted area of effect. Either way, you don't want to be in front of him when one of those goes off.
Need some help with this one. Hand is locked.
And so, yeah, it's literally, he destroys everything in front of him.
Commencing tactical assessment. Grid
Shining. When either of those go off, so. Killing the tar out of him in an attempt to stop him. There we go. Another Hellfire Trooper. So, yeah, you can see the Hellfire armor. The Hellfire Troopers were actually added in the first DLC in order to make the game harder. That's kind of the level of mobs we're facing here. Oh, I wish that pillar wasn't there. No, no, no. This is how you punch something. And this is how you kick something. American soil, lethal force, and KOG. Liberate communism is the very definition of failure. Freedom. Freedom is the sovereign right of every American. Engaging from Chinese aggressors. Oh, God. Yeah, see? Hello. My shoes. Falling off a cliff! There he is. He's hiding behind the car. Gotcha. Blammo! It's one of those things, or a timed event that, you know, they really kind of push you to make sure that it gives you the feel that what was that apparel? It's very urgent and very dramatic, and you have to keep up. Now, Liberty Prime gets so far away from you and he just stops. There's just really no point in especially if you're doing any kind of struggling to keep up with him. Oh, here we go. Now, Liberty Brime knocks down the final barrier. We take a left, and up here, out of Liberty Prime's reach, are a whole bunch of Enclave soldiers. So, it's time to play. Okay, Bethany. Wrecking ball mode. Engage. Hide behind the pile of dead Enclave. And it looks like we've mopped up all of the outside Enclave.
Need something, friend? Stay sharp and stick close to me until we're in the control room.
Oh, I'm crippled. When did that happen? Did the quest update? Reach the control room, yes, all right. With the help of a stealth boy, we're going to sneak in.
Lethal force authorized.
Yes, this guy, both of them are still moving. Well, one of them are still moving. Oh, kick to the head. Knocked it clean off. Look at that. Liquefied that guy inside his armor. Yeah, no more blips.
You again.
Me
again.
I
can't say I'm surprised. You and your ilk seem hell-bent on destroying everything our government has worked to achieve. There's nothing to stop me from killing you this time. Let's end this.
I don't want to fight you.
You don't have to. Just stand there. It'll be over quicker and might even be less painful for you.
Oh, ho, ho, ho. And down goes Colonel Autumn. That armor looks like it looks like XO1 armor from Fallout 4. The overlarge shoulder pads. Enclave Power Armor Mark 1.
Well, that takes care of that. By now, the Pride should be mopping up whatever opposition is left outside. Let's get this room secured.
Here is Colonel Autumn's unique plasma pistol and his unique outfit.
It's Sarah Lyons. I'm in the control room. We're both here. What's... going on?
I've been monitoring the equipment remotely, and we have a serious problem.
And here's Colonel Autumn's outfit.
Some of it looks accidental, some of it may have been sabotage.
There's pressure building up in the holding tanks. It needs to be released now, or else the whole facility could explode. To release the pressure, you're going to have to turn the purifier on. Do you understand me? It has to be turned on now! If I'm reading this right, I'm afraid there are lethal levels of radiation inside the chamber. I'm sorry. I wish there were some other way, but there's just no time. It has to be done now, or the damage will be catastrophic.
Well, so much for celebrating. One of us is going to have to go in there and turn the damn thing on. And whoever does it isn't coming back out. Not exactly how I imagine going out, you know? So, what should we do? Draw straws?
Interesting to note, you can do it, try to figure out a different way, or say that refuse to do it, in which case she goes into the chamber. The chamber is flooded with resurrection, so whoever goes in there will die, quote-unquote. You notice that she's wearing power armor, which is known for its radiation-resistant qualities. If you have Fox, the super mutant, who has said that he is immune to radiation, you can send him in. Either way, the job gets done with no loss of life, but that is considered a selfish end, and so you get the bad end, which is mind-bending, to say the least. Or you do it yourself, and your self-sacrifice gives you the good ending.
You're going to have to be quick about it. If the radiation is bad enough, you won't have much time. I won't forget what you've done here. No one will. Thank you.
Also, if you have the FEV virus, you go over here, it says activate the auxiliary filtration input. That's where you put the FEV virus for that particular ending. And here's the keyboard for the activation code, which you actually have to punch in. Interesting to note, if you're playing with the Children of the Wastelands mod, your character is actually going to be too small to reach the upper buttons, and so can't access the code. You have to enter console command, set size to 100, which makes you the size of a normal adult, and then there's some collision here. Jump up. Hey, I can access the top buttons and enter the code. And that is the official ending to the base game of Fallout 3.
And so it was that the Lone Wanderer ventured forth from Vault 101, intent on discovering the fate of a father who had once sacrificed the future of humanity for that of his only child. The Capital Wasteland proved a cruel, inhospitable place, but the Lone Wanderer refused to surrender to the vices that had claimed so many others. The values passed on from father to child: selflessness, compassion, honor, guided this noble soul through countless trials and triumphs. But it was not until the end of this long road that the Lone Wanderer learned the true meaning of that greatest of virtues, sacrifice. Stepping into the irradiated control chamber of Project Purity, the child followed the example of the father, sacrificing life itself for the greater good of mankind. Thankfully, when selected by the sinister president to be his instrument of annihilation, the Wanderer refused. Humanity, with all its flaws, was deemed worthy of preservation. The waters of life flowed at last, free and pure for any and all. The Capital Wasteland, at long last, was saved. So ends the story of the Lone Wanderer, who stepped through the great door of Vault 101 and into the annals of legend. But the tale of humanity will never come to a close, for the struggle of survival is a war without end. And war never changes.
The ending narration, of course, performed by Ron Perlman, actor known for performances in such movies as The Tear-Jerking City of Lost Children. It's interesting to note that they chose Three Dog, the guy who refused to help you until you did something for him first, as the audio depiction of selflessness. And I'm going to call the episode there. I thank you for watching, and hope you have a great night.
If you were entertained or educated at all, a thumbs up is always appreciated. Leave your questions, comments, and suggestions below. If you want to follow my series, feel free to subscribe. Outfoxed, a glorious tribute to doing things the hard way.